Since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today, we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of the Lord's Paschal mystery. That is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his home city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in the resurrection and in this life. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
When Jesus and the disciples drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find an ass tethered and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them here to me. And if anyone should say anything to you, reply, 'The master has needed them.' And he will send them at once." Now this happened so that what had been spoken through the prophet might be fulfilled. "Say to daughter Zion, 'Behold, your king comes to you, meek and riding on an ass, and on a colt full of beasts of burden.'" So the disciples went and did as Jesus had ordered them. They brought the ass, the colt, and laid their cloaks over them, and he sat upon them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and strewed them on the ground. Crowds preceding him and those following kept crying out, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was shaken and asked, "Who is this?" And the crowds replied, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
Let us pray.
Give me a trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse it. Morning after morning, he opens my ear, that I might hear. And I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield, buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Better for that man if he had never been born.
Then Judas, his betrayer, said in reply,
surely it is not I, Lord.
He answered,
you have said it so.
While they were eating, Jesus took bread, said the blessing, broke it, giving it to his disciples, said,
Take and eat. This is my body.
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying,
Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed on behalf of many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, from now on, I shall not drink of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you new in the kingdom of my Father.
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
This night all of you will have your faith in me shaken, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be dispersed. But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him in reply,
Though all may have their faith in you shaken, mine will never be.
Jesus said to him,
Amen, I say to you, this very night before the cock crows, you will deny me three times.
Peter said to him,
Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you.
And all the disciples spoke likewise. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
Sit here while I go over there and pray.
He took along Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to feel sorrow and distress. Then he said to them,
My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch with me.
He advanced a little and fell prostrate in prayer, saying,
My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will.
When he returned to his disciples, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
So you could not keep watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Withdrawing a second time, he prayed again,
My Father, if it is possible that this cup pass without my drinking it, your will be done.
Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open. He left them and withdrew again and prayed a third time, saying the same thing again. He then returned to his disciples and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Behold, the hour is at hand when the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. Look, my betrayer is at hand.
While he was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a large crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests and the elders of the people. His betrayer had arranged a sign with them, saying,
The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him.
Immediately he went over to Jesus and said,
Hail, Rabbi.
And he kissed him. Jesus answered him,
Friend, do what you have come for.
And stepping forward, they laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. And behold, one of those who accompanied Jesus put his hand to his sword, drew it, and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him,
Put your sword back into its sheath, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot call upon my Father, and he will not provide me at this moment with more than 12 legions of angels? But then, how would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say that it must come to pass in this way?
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I sat teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me. But all this has come to pass that the writings of the prophets may be fulfilled.
Then all the disciples left him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus led him away to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled. Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the high priest's courtyard, and going inside, he sat down with the servants to see the outcome. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain false testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward who stated,
This man said, I can destroy the temple of God and within 3 days rebuild it.
The high priest rose and addressed him,
Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
I order you to tell under oath before the living God whether you are the Christ, the Son of God.
Jesus said to him in reply,
You have said so, but I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven.
Then the high priest tore his robes and said,
"He has blasphemed. What further need have we of witnesses? You now have heard the blasphemy. What is your opinion?"
He said in reply,
"He deserves to die."
Then they spat in his face and struck him, while some slapped him, saying,
"Prophesy for us, Christ. Who is it that struck you?"
Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. One of the maids came over to him and said,
"You too were with Jesus of Galilee."
But he denied it in front of everyone, saying,
"I do not know what you are talking about."
As he went out to the gate, another girl saw him and said to those who were there,
"This man was with Jesus the Nazarene."
Again, he denied it with an oath,
"I do not know the man."
A little later, the bystanders came over and said to Peter,
"Surely, you too are one of them. Even your speech gives you away."
At that, he began to curse and to swear,
"I do not know the man."
And immediately a cock crowed. Then Peter remembers the word that Jesus had spoken, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." He went out and began to weep bitterly. When it was morning, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. They bound him and led him away. They handed him over to Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that Jesus had been condemned, deeply regretted what he had done. He returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying,
"I have sinned in betraying innocent blood."
They said,
"What is that to us? Look to it yourself."
Flinging the money into the temple, he departed and went off and hanged himself. The chief priest gathered up the money, but said,
"It is not lawful to deposit this in the temple treasury, for it is the Christ's blood."
After consultation, they used it to buy the potter's field as a burial place for foreigners. That is why that field even today is called the Field of Blood. Then was fulfilled what had been said through Jeremiah the prophet. And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the value of a man with a price on his head, a price set by some of the Israelites, and they paid it out for the potter's field, just as the Lord had commanded me. Now Jesus stood before the governor, Pontius Pilate, and he questioned him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus said,
"You say so."
And when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he made no answer. Then Pilate said to him,
"Do you not hear how many things they are testifying against you?"
But he did not answer him one word, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now, on that occasion of the feast, the governor was accustomed to release to the crowd one prisoner whom he wished. And at that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had assembled, Pilate said to them,
"Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus Christ?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that they had handed him over. While he was still seated on the bench, his wife sent him a message, "Have nothing to do with this righteous man. I suffered much in a dream today because of him." The chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas, but to destroy Jesus. The governor said to them in reply,
"Which of the two do you wish me to release to you?"
They answered,
"Barabbas."
Pilate said to them,
"Then what shall I do with Jesus called the Christ?"
They all said,
"Let him be crucified."
But he said,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They only shouted the louder,
"Let him be crucified."
When Pilate saw that he was not succeeding at all, but that a riot was breaking out instead, he took water and washed his hands in the sight of the crowd, saying,
"I am innocent of this man's blood. Look to it yourself."
And the whole people said in reply,
"His blood be upon us and upon our children."
Then he released Barabbas to them. But after he had Jesus scourged, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers and the governor took Jesus inside the praetorium and gathered the whole court around him. They stripped off his clothes and threw a scarlet military cloak about him. Weaving a crown of thorns, they placed it on his head, and a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying,
"Hail, the King of the Jews."
They spat upon him and took the reed and kept striking him on the head.
And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him off to crucify him. As they were going out, they met a Cyrenian named Simon. This man they pressed into service and carried him his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha,
set me free, your being broken body.
In a very special way, please help me to thank all the priests who are present who have association with the night. And all three of them were part of the exemplification too. I took my fourth degree way long time ago in the early 90s. So that's when I did my fourth degree. And now I can talk to them and I don't have to kill them by Now they're part of the society and part of the club, which is one of them. A great club. And a great sign and a great symbol, which is tremendous for all of us in the church. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Remember me.
forward our friar, Father Hauer, and please remain standing after the prayer for the presentation of the colors. Please.
From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to sky to sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, there's pride in every American heart.
Thank you. I'm not making them nervous, am I?
Uh-oh.
Yeah, right.
I've never met a camera I haven't liked yet.
He knows it's not still camera, so he can give it an action shot.
That's right.
They've got a shortage of helpers out there, and they call a priest and whatever, but somehow they keep us going. One other point of information that I'd like to share with you, I was honored to be the ambassador of ceremonies earlier this year at the Archdiocesan Holy Name. It's an award where we give away what we call the Only Jesus Award, and I'm very happy to announce that our very worthy Archbishop was a recipient of that award. So it was again an honor. So without anything further, I just want to welcome you on behalf of the Area 2 Assemblies, of which, in case you don't know, there's Cardinal Meyer, the Basilica of St. Joseph Potts, Sacred Heart Assembly, Bishop Henai Assembly, and my own assembly, Monsignor Arnold. So thank you again, all of you, for being with us. And again, Your Excellency, thank you.
I'd like to present this to Jerry Falk, awarded to the following host assemblies, 1196, 1304, 1307, 3210, 3316. For the outstanding dedication and support, both in the 4th Queen, Eastern Wisconsin District Exemplification, April 12, 2014. Congratulations. I'd now like to call our Western Master, Sonai Ron Shemansky, for his welcome.
Archbishop Listecki, we bid you a hearty welcome from the Western District. We congratulate all the new Sir Knights who joined the 4th Degree today. What a privilege it is to have Archbishop Listecki as your class honoree. Archbishop Listecki is a very, very strong supporter of the Knights of Columbus. You will never forget who your honoree was today. I ask you, Sir Knights and Ladies, to recruit new Knights to join the 4th Degree. There will be an exemplification in Schofield on October 25th this year, and I believe yours is April 11th in Appleton in 2015. Become active immediately in your assembly. We always need your help. We also need to thank our ladies. We need to thank our ladies for their support that they give the Knights of Columbus. Kathy and I want to thank Roland and Judy for their great hospitality this weekend. Thank you, and may God bless.
Excellency Bishop Listecki, Reverend Fathers, worthy State Deputy, worthy State Officers, worthy Masters, worthy former Masters, brothers, sir knights, ladies, I bring you greetings from my boss, Dennis Stoddard, the Supreme Master. He would have been very honored to be here at this exemplification today. One of the things that I really was impressed with, and to the priests that took their 4th degree today, we need your help in the Knights of Columbus. Very much so. You talk about the Knights of Columbus on the pulpit. We get more members that you really realize. And I want to thank you. I want to thank the Bishop for the continued support that you give us. I would like to also congratulate the Degree team. Yes, they did a wonderful job today. What do you new members think? Did you receive the message of patriotism today? Yes. you as brothers or knights are going to be looked up to, and we hope that the worthy master or your area coordinator will have a form board to hand to you at your next fourth degree meeting so you can recruit new members. To you young gentlemen, to all of you that have came into the fourth degree today, consider being an officer. We, the elder statesmen, I put myself in that position, and all of us, I think, appear at the head table pretty much. We need your help. We need new ideas. And the survival of not just the fourth degree, but of the third degree depends on our younger generation. I'm very impressed to see the young new members that came in today. And while we're on that subject, to you that do not know, 2 years ago, the Supreme Council had made a new ruling that anyone joining the Knights of Columbus can become a fourth degree member as soon as they receive the first, second, and third degree. So remember that. If you have someone, and I have been to Exemplification for the Sir Knight, the new Sir Knight was in the Knights of Columbus for 1 week, but he had all 3 degrees. So remember when you do this, to please work with getting that they do not have to wait. We have lost members over the years because of this. We are 1.8 million strong. Of that, 335,000 are fourth degree knights. Today, we have another 96. We have been doing very well in the Marquette Province this past year, as we have in the past few years. So we must continue to recruit. The Knights of Columbus is one of the very few organizations. Yes, we're growing at a slower pace, but we must continue to recruit new members. Military scholarship. I think most of you know what that has been going on for 3 years. As of Wednesday, we have collected $710,000. Worthy Sir Knights, thank you, and ladies. If you need more information on this, please contact your master or talk to your officers in the fourth degree. I want to thank the State Council also for helping us with this, getting this money in. The Marquette Province, for the last 3 years, we have quotas of $4,000 per state that we must get in. We have exceeded that every year. So again, thank you. And Roland, I want to thank you. I want to thank you for a wonderful weekend. I've enjoyed it. Judy, we always know who's behind the good man. Thank you. You ladies, I really do want to thank you because I know where I would be. I can look out over the crowd and look at the gentlemen smiling out there. They know where they'd be if we did not have our ladies supporting us and making sure we get things done. Again, thank you. Give you.
Archbishop Listecki, worthy master, more than I can count. And all of you who honor and are members of the Knights of Columbus and your associated family members. What I'm going to say is no surprise to you. You've heard it a few times already. But this is my swan song for it. I'm here speaking for adoptions in our church, by members of our church. I am here to ask that we be supportive of couples and families who want to adopt, if they have the stability of family and the means to do so. One voice is not enough, however, and this voice is gone. So I would hope that out of the state of Wisconsin, there would be a Knight of Columbus, especially,
fourth degree, Knight of Columbus, who will stand up and ask that we be conscious of the need for adoptions and foster care for children. I have no idea who it will be, but I have some confidence that the Holy Spirit will touch one of you, or maybe more of you, and that you will speak for these children who have no voice here. Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to call forward our worthy state deputy, Jim Gempy, for his welcome.
Reverend Fathers, worthy masters, former masters, my fellow state officers, and my brother sir knights and ladies. Master Roland, I want to congratulate you and your team on an excellent degree today and doing a fantastic job of bringing in 96 new sir knights. Congratulations, great job. Take the opportunity to speak to the new Sir Knights. Today you were taught the lesson of patriotism. I hope you take that lesson home and share it with your fellow knights, your fellow Catholics. Not only in your assemblies, but also in your councils. Because today when you became a Sir Knight, you took on a new duty in the Knights of Columbus. You went up that next step higher. You're the most visible arm of the Knights of Columbus. You're in our churches. You're in our schools. You're presenting the Knights of Columbus in the Honor Guard and the Color Guard. You, as Sir Knights, are what most of the people remember our Knights of Columbus. But that's the visible arm. We also have the duty to exemplify or to teach the lesson of patriotism and to live it. Because only the Knights of Columbus can teach that lesson in patriotism. We're all patriots in our country. We all exercise the right to vote. We all are Catholics and live with our faith on our shirt sleeve. But only brother sir knights blend the two together, patriotism and our faith. In degrees, we learned that we have the duty to voice our public opinion, to make us known what we believe in our faith is the true faith. We have the duty to set that shining example. We have the duty to mold public opinions. And that's what you, as worthy sir knights, need to take back to your assemblies and be that shining example. Archbishop Listecki, I want to let you know the Knights of Columbus in the Wisconsin jurisdiction is here to support bishops and the church in all phases. We are here to be your right arm, to help you challenge and mold that public opinion. Please utilize us. Please allow us to be the voice that we can be for you. My ladies and the sir knights, without you, we cannot do anything.
but because of you that we are allowed to go out and practice and be able to mold that public opinion. Thank you. Viva Jesus.
97 tonight. One thing. Going to sell me 1197 in recognition of your significant efforts in the most raffle tickets sold in 2013, 1,375. In recognition of your significant efforts in the most raffle tickets sold per member, 8.78 in 2013, Sacred Heart Assembly 3316. All these gentlemen up and stand them up in front of the podium, please. Reverend William Howard, Charles Andrew Holmich, John Hogner Jr., Richard Briskey, Michael Jordan, Michael Angeli, Ed Vandenblumen Jr., Carl Vandenberg. Fourth degree Supreme Assembly degree certification. Let it be known that these gentlemen and your is hereby certified as a fourth degree ceremonial degree officer for mastery of this role, which teaches the virtue of patriotism to advance candidates to the honors of a Sir Knight and the Knights of Columbus. Religiously devoted and patriotically proud, Sir Knights must always know and understand that the freedoms we enjoy are divine blessings bestowed upon mankind by our good and gracious God. Signed by our Supreme Knight, Carl A. Anderson. Congratulations, gentlemen. Exemplification was conducted in honor of Sir Knight Archbishop Jerome E. Listecki.
as an expression of appreciation for our service to the Knights of Columbus. In recognition of Class Honoree, His Excellency Jerome E. Listecki, Archbishop of the Milwaukee Archdiocese of Wisconsin for the Knights of Columbus 4th Degree Exemplification, Eastern Wisconsin District, Marriott West, Milwaukee, Waukesha, Wisconsin, on April 12, 2014. And as we do every year for our Class Honoree, and thank you from Assembly Fall 11, say it right? Fall. Fond du Lac, Fall 11, we'd like to present you with the United States flag.
Thank you.
Finally, on behalf of the Eastern District Knights of Columbus, the 4th Degree, we'd like to present you with a check for $500 to use how you see fit.
For the longest time, I've always had an affection for the Knights. My affection for the Knights goes back to the fact that you exemplify and what you stand for, the great principles, not only on which our country is founded, but really the ability to understand the connection to one's faith to really serve as citizens of this country. In 2000, I was appointed pastor of St. Ignatius Parish in Chicago. And in St. Ignatius Parish in Chicago, there's some beautiful stained glass windows, one's 44 feet high and 18 feet wide. So I just ask you to kind of picture it in your mind. And many times when I was there, I was still carrying rank and active in the military. Some of my reserve units would visit me. And then, of course, they would want to see the church. So probably I'd take them into the church and would walk in and they would spot, and then they would guess. And then now, not what you think of, not the beauty, but they would guess because the stained glass had a picture of heaven, and then therefore the saints flanking God either side, and the angels going all the way down to basically the ground where there was, and this was done after World War I, a sailor and a soldier, and the soldier was cupping the flag. Flag was on the ground. Ah, see? Then I had to remind them that in heaven and earth, everything bows before God. And they go, yeah, you're right. Well, our patriotism that we have is founded in our faith in God. It's what makes us truly patriots, to understand that our advocacy for freedom, our understanding of that freedom, exists in a transcendent God who grants those freedoms. And that's why they're essential. Not only because they've been contracted by our government, but because our government's founded on the understanding that those are the natural principles upon which the dignity of every human being exists. Our freedoms. I say that to you as knights and ladies because at this time in our history, we must be vigilant. We must be the voice for the freedom to practice religion. We must be. We must be the voice of the unborn. We must be the voice of those who are looking to the end of their lives to die natural deaths. We must be the voice of true marriage between a man and a woman.
poor and the neglected, who in our society and in our country, given the wonderful gifts that we have been given and resources, there should never be a child that goes hungry or a person that's homeless. We have to understand who we are as Americans and our responsibility as brothers and sisters to one another. When I take a look at it, even in the aspect of, when we're taking a look at something which is so critical to all of us, even as immigration, we've got to realize that our country is built on immigrants. And now when we're faced with the aspect of taking a look at those immigrants among us, we must find the solutions to be able to integrate those individuals who are among us who might be denied their own individual rights or their own individual participation in our great country, because our greatness comes from that. Our ability to reach out and to bring people and to assimilate into our country and to the understanding of those rights, those duties of democracy which we so cherish so much. So I thank the Knights, and those who are honor guards know that I never fail to single them out, especially for their tremendous support for pro-life and for vocations and Catholic education. My sense is your understanding of patriotism coupled with faith only makes all of us and our country better. God bless all of you, and thank you for your time.
We have one more presentation, so please stay standing. Tonight, Jerry Falk.
For the Archbishop, before departing, the Honor Guard members of Area 2 Assemblies have one more presentation for you. And I'd like to call on our Area 2 Commander, Frank Weisenberger, to bring the presentation up to the front. Your Excellency, our one major concern is that there might be an occasion of once in a while that we cannot be there to be your defender. So on those occasions, we want to present you with your own personal sword.
Thank you very much for the sword, and I will have Father Lovast arm himself with this. But realize he has to strap it next to the M16.
Going up, I don't have the exact number, but we're in the 90s for candidates. We had 380 for the banquet, and I believe 90 for the ladies' luncheon, which are all super numbers, so thank you very much. Think about this now, we're a year away, but April 11th we'll be up at the Paper Valley in Appleton, and I'm very honored and proud to say that Bishop Ricken will be our honoree up in the Appleton Paper Valley next year. What an honor to have another bishop as an honoree. So why join the Board to be Knights of Columbus? Oh glory, the flag of the United States of America. We love it and shall ever defend it. The flag represents freedom, liberty, patriotism, our Constitution, our Bill of Rights. or to be knights act on these principles and what is right and honorable. How? By supporting and defending truth in the public arena. Protecting faith and civic life, such as the American examples of one nation under God and the Pledge of Allegiance, and in God we trust on our currency. Funding, restoring, and serving in church, initiative and events. Patriotism, the fourth principle of our order, is loyalty to that principle. For to be knights, strong and unwaveringly to what is right and honorable. For to be knights, are committed to building lives of character. Patriotism and pride in one's nation is the driving force behind more than 300,000 Fourth Degree members in over 3,000 Fourth Degree assemblies. The Fourth Degree is the highest and most prestigious degree within the Knights of Columbus. It is a group of outstanding Sir Knights who are dedicated to the service of their church, their country, and our order. These men are unified in the Fourth Degree when duty exceeds beyond our own lives, beyond how we lead our families, and into how we serve our fellow men. Honoring the legacy of knighthood, the Honor Guard is an elective division of the Fourth Degree, whose distinctive presence in parades, wreath-laying ceremonials, flag retirements, wakes, funerals, and Catholic functions is a visible reminder of our service to the community. Honor Guard members wear their colors with pride, knowing they represent the best of the Knights of Columbus. The need for strong role models has never been greater. If the sanctity of life, family values, and true religious freedom are to survive, democratic nations need greater commitment from people of faith. That's what the Fourth Degree represents. We are the pinnacle of knighthood. We live, serve, and protect the truth. Great things have been done for love of country, but the greatest things have been done for our love of God and country. I hope each of you obtain the joy and satisfaction reaching the highest degree of our order. May your new role as Sir Knight continue to provide you the opportunity to serve God, our church, our families, and our brother knights. Sir Knight is more than a title. It's an honor. God bless all of you.
If tomorrow all the things were gone, for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American. The men who died, who gave that right to me, and I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say, defend her. today, 'cause there ain't no doubt.